So, welcome. So nice to see you all. It's a lovely evening, and I'm so glad to see you all here to support this wonderful cause, and which you're going to hear about very soon. I just want to very quickly thank, first of all of you for being here, of course. By contributing to this event, we raised over $18,000. And these funds are earmarked towards Dr. Karanth's Tiger program in India, which I've been a fan of and follower of for many years, and he's been doing for almost 3 decades. And I'd love to also thank the ladies of ABC Home, who have donated this space, and all the beautiful decor, Paula, Paulette, Amy, and the entire team of people who work with them. Really appreciate it. And last but not least, this evening wouldn't happen if there wasn't a certain someone named Krishna Das. So, thank you for being here, and we're all here because of him. All the musicians who are singing tonight are also donating their time and energy, and I'm very grateful. And we also have some special guests tonight, Sharon Gannon. So I won't say very much because I'd like to give the mic to Dr. Karanth. But I just wanted to mention, you know, there was recently I was reading the Ramayana over again for heaven knows how many times. And one of the things that's talked about in the Ramayana is how Ram was sent into the forest to protect the rishis who were doing their practice there from the demons who were disrupting their practice. And it's said that when the rishis were in the forest doing their practice was so intense and the chanting of the Vedas was so deep that the very leaves of the trees in the forest resonated with the sound of those sacred names and those sacred verses. So in this present day and age, Dr. Karanth is the guardian of the forest. Truly, you'll see with the work he does how he's able to preserve these last tracts of wild land and ancient forest where the tiger and many other wildlife species actually live free. It's an amazing thing. And we're so grateful for him for doing that. And so we'll bring the chanting back together. We'll do that together and support what he's doing. Thank you all again. And have a wonderful evening.
Thank you, Reena. Namaskar. It's a pleasure to be here in New York amidst Indians. I see the chaos of India in some sense here. It makes me feel very much at home. India was defined as a functioning anarchy by Galbraith in 1960. It still is, functions. I'm 100% Indian, the real one, the real one. I'm going to talk about my work dealing with a part of India that is not as much appreciated as the other part of India, which is our culture, our religion, our sculpture, our art. There's a natural India. So I'm going to talk about this natural India today in my talk and my engagement in some sense of trying to protect it, what remains of it, which is not very much. I work for the Wildlife Conservation Society, which is barely known because we don't do much PR, but we run the Bronx Zoo and all of the zoos and the aquarium in New York. But it's little known that from the 1950s, we have built an international program with 300 plus scientists working in 50 countries trying to save wild lands and wildlife. That's our mission. So I have been working in India for the last 30 years, ever since I graduated from the University of Florida with the wildlife degree. And I'm going to tell a story about one piece of land in which I grew up in, which I continue to work in, but with support from a great American institution that has a vision of saving nature across the world. Can we have tigers here? Does it look possible? Actually, it does. But it's a huge challenge and remarkably successful challenge in some sense that's been met, which I didn't think 50 years ago when I was a schoolboy that challenge would ever be met. This picture captures the present day India, 60% rural, 60% of the human population depending on biomass, wood for energy, livestock raising. This is a big poor India of 800 million plus people. Superimposed on that, now we have 300 million strong middle class, there's a growing economy, and reconciling all these needs, both of the rural and the urban sectors and the growing economy, how do you save nature in the middle of it all? That's basically the theme I'm covering. This is the modern India. When I was born in 1948, life expectancy in India was 30 years for an average. Now 62 years. Obviously things have gotten better. The story that India is a basket case is not right. We have a $2 trillion economy that's now the 10th largest in the world. We are very proud of our ancient culture, our dance, our traditions, both classical and folk. And rightly we should be proud of it because very few countries, perhaps China, a few others, have this deep culture. Our religion, our sculpture, all other things that everybody identifies with, and obviously you are a group who vibes with this very much, so you get this. But what we don't get is the fact that human beings came to India 60,000 years ago, walked across from Africa. But 60 million years ago, continental drift, geologic events, geological history of the earth created something incredible, which was this piece broke off from another continent and pushed against India, the mainland Asia. Himalayas rose, the Ganga flowed, all that happened 60 million years ago. As a consequence of that geological history and evolution, nothing that we Indians or any human being did. Today, India is the greatest repository of natural diversity in the world. We have, you'll be surprised, we have the lion from the Africa, we have the leopard, the hyenas from Africa, we have the grizzly bear, the red fox, and the elk from the colder Northern Asia and North America. We also have typical Asian species like the tiger, the elephant, and the rhino. In one country, there's no other country that captures it, and we as Indians must be very humble that we had no role in it. We have to have the humbleness to recognize that this is something that came to us much before our religion, culture, and everything. And it's something, to me, it's an ethical value that we need to fight to protect it, not just what we as humans create. Looking at, India occupies just 2% of the Earth's surface, but we have 13% of the world's birds, 7% of the world mammals. I know most of you and many Indians are vegetarians, but we have 24% of the world's carnivorous species. And this diversity is incredible. It encompasses amphibians, it encompasses birds, and most difficult to preserve are these large-bodied animals, the large mammals, which are the hardest to protect given the kind of pressures that I talked about. He is a vegetarian, no steroids. The largest wild cattle in the world, gaur or Indian bison. Elephant, this is my landscape, this is my home. Asian elephant, which is different from the African elephant. Specialized species like a bear that is specialized to eat termites. Asian wild dogs, which hunt in packs, lovely creatures. Leopards. Actually, leopards have come back big time in India. And the tiger, which is a species that I'm obsessed with. As I grew up, as a little boy in a part of the landscape in India, this is around Mangalore, where Meena also comes from, the southwestern Indian state of Karnataka. There's a landscape called Malanad, which is a spectacular landscape. Right everywhere else, animals are very, very deeply rooted in the Indian culture, in the Indian folk arts. You look at the Bastar tribal tiger, that's a Huliyappa, the tiger god from Karnataka, and that's a tiger dance from Mangalore. I used to follow these troops of tiger dancers. There is so much a part of our culture, yet we seem to be forgetting it. So when I grew up in this landscape in the 50s, I hiked these mountains. It's a spectacular landscape. Forests were being cut, tigers and leopards were being shot and paraded in the streets of my little town. There was no law to protect nature. As a 15-year-old boy, I was desperate. I thought everything would go, everything would be lost. But something changed. In the 70s, several things happened. There's a group of middle class Indians, the early generation of pioneers of Indian conservation like Salim Ali and others, said we need to conserve these things. We can't let it go. Some of them were even hunters. And we had Mrs. Gandhi, who was sufficiently educated about nature to really say, okay, we must do it. And we had a bureaucracy called the Forest Service that actually had the law enforcement. And suddenly things started coming back in the 70s. And to me, it was in some sense a miracle. And I was an engineering student studying in National Institute of Technology, Suratkal, because every middle class Indian kid of my age at that time went to engineering school, because that's where. But my passion was in wildlife. And I read an article in the Life magazine by Dr. George Schaller, the greatest living wildlife biologist. He's now 81, also works for me. About how he studied tigers using science in 1963 in central India, and it opened my eyes. It was like having a cataract operation. Suddenly I realized all this tiger lore I read, it meant nothing. If you didn't have the lens of science, you wouldn't understand the tiger. So I said, I'm going to move away from engineering and really become a biologist. It took me a couple of decades to steer towards that. This is Dr. Shalu and I measuring it all. So, after graduating from Florida, fortunately for me, Dr. Schaller picked me up for WCS, Wildlife Conservation Society, and said, go do your thing. As long as you work in India and recover wildlife, that's your mandate. We will help you from here. So I went and started studying. At that time, tigers had not been studied at all, except one study in Nepal. Nobody knew how to study them. So we put radio collars on tigers, we caught them, and literally I lived in the jungle with this tigress called Sundari for 6 years, tracking her movements. My wife got jealous actually, because I spent only one day in a week with my wife, 5 days with Sundari. So that's Sundari scent marking her territory. So this kind of deeply living with the tigers gave me insights as to what constitutes a tiger, what makes it tick, how do they share space, how do they raise cubs, how long do they live? All these really interesting pieces of information came together. And it was a revelation, because suddenly I realized, although Indian parks are very small, they are very productive. There's a lot of prey once it's protected. So a lot of tigers can be packed into a small area. Say 30 times more tigers than say in Russia, because the habitat is extremely productive. These insights come from research. So, around this time, the rising affluence of Chinese middle class and the demand for bones started putting a big pressure. I'm talking of 1990, and I said, you know, my dream days of just watching tiger behavior are over. There's a serious crisis, tiger numbers are dipping, but the government had a very shoddy system of counting tigers using tracks, which simply didn't work. So I had to develop a better method, and I developed this method called camera trapping, where you put automated cameras in the forest. Tigers come and take their own pictures. And they take beautiful pictures. And some of them are really prima donnas. They kind of parade in front of the cameras. curiosity didn't kill this cat. It got his nice picture, he's a cat. So, using this new technology, I was able to get a handle on how tiger populations function. And essentially, today, switching gears, all the, you know, we have a concept called Abhayaranya. That is from the days of Ashoka, of sacred areas protected for animals. Today you see any ancient, there will be a rishi, but there will be cheetal, deer around the ashram. This idea of natural protected areas goes back a long way, but somewhere along the way we lost sight of it, and it took the Brits to come back and start in sense, bring in the modern natural history, modern science to reinvigorate those values we have of protected areas where nature is sacred. It's not just a 5-acre sacred grove. We are talking about hundreds of square kilometers of large sacred groves, which I call sacred groves for the 22nd century. So these little dots are less than 4% of India's land area. To say that an ancient culture like ours, with all its generosity of spirit and its admiration for nature, cannot afford this is nonsense, in my opinion. We need to protect these pieces of nature that are there, but it's complicated. There are problems that have to be dealt with. Because tigers are large meat-eating animals, they're not vegans like many of you. And putting tigers and people together in a real landscape takes a lot of hard work. And one of the issues is, even within the protected area, there are human communities, human settlements, and that leads to serious conflicts. When you put cows and tigers together, the tigers kill the cows, and the tigers get killed in retaliation. And these pressures are also now being connected to global markets in tiger trade, tiger body parts, rhino body parts. So the need for creating a win-win solution where the tiger and other wildlife, I'm using the tiger simply as an icon. Obviously, it's about saving everything else, the water, the springs, the other species. Means there's a whole complicated set of things you have to do. You need that science, which I put here, because mere passion won't do anything. Passion will drive you, but without knowledge, that passion can't be translated into meaningful action. Second thing is protection and law enforcement. There's a law enforcement machinery, but you know how the government of India is. You need to push it to make it work. Then we have the issue of advocacy and litigation sometimes. When dams and mines are imposed on these areas, you have to fight. Fortunately, we have an open society and a democracy, and we can do that. And lastly, for the long term, people who are embedded in tiger areas, find them a better livelihood so the tiger and people can both live. So these are four pillars on which we have been working. And it's been interesting because when I started working as a scientist, I was alone. But middle class youth from small towns like Chikmagalur, Mysore, came to me and said, we want to do field work with you. And these are middle class boys. I took them for walks, I made them get bitten by ticks and chased by elephants, and 90% ran away never to come back again. But the 10% who came back formed a core. Today they were 18. Now they are all in their 40s, formed a network of conservation groups that WCS supports who take on this cause. They have the social traction, they are from this locality, they have the passion for wildlife, tempered by real science rather than raw emotion, and they are delivering conservation. Just to give you some example, the guy here is a customs inspector. He got so fascinated by all this, he left customs department, which is a very lucrative department in India, to join my team. This guy is a coffee farmer called Girish from Chikmagalur. Today he's the most passionate advocate of people moving out of parks, protection of parks. He's very good at harassing Indian bureaucrats. And this is Muthanna, who was a journalist who came to interview me. I was so impressed by his passion that made him close down his tabloid and join my team. He has incredible influence with religious leaders, tribal people. He works with them to motivate them to move out of these areas using all the social traction that it can bring. And when we move people out, it's not just throw them out business. You stay engaged with them, look after their welfare, take care of their needs, so they are happy. So I ended up starting as an engineer, a tiger biologist. Now we do a lot of this stuff, which is not what I wanted to do, but this is what actually saves time. But just like a shrewd businessman, you have to have metrics of success. Spending your life, spending money is okay. But if it's not yielding the result, what you want is recovery of tigers. So we have the largest tiger monitoring project in the world with automated cameras spread across this huge landscape south of Goa up to North Kerala. We document tigers. We have more than 800 tigers in our database. They die, they turn over, but overall, very accurate scientific measurements. And it clearly shows the parks that we started working in are some of these two parks. This whole landscape now has the largest wild tiger population in the world. When I grew up, I showed you that picture with dark clouds. There were less than 50 tigers in those areas. Today, there are more than 400. India's population has increased. Everything has, one would say, oh, you couldn't forecast this. You couldn't, because we can always make a difference. And I'm not claiming this credit for myself. It is WCS, it's my teammate, it's the Indian government, it's the forest department, it's the public, it's the culture of tolerance that's embedded in India that's enabled this recovery using modern science. So I don't see the growth of India, economic growth of India is posing challenges, but for the first time I'm also seeing some hope. Because in the 60s, when I was just out of school, Indians were starving. PM480 food was coming from Kansas to feed starving Indians. I thought all parks would go. It didn't go. Somehow it survived. Now we have all the resources. All we need in the current government is a little more wisdom and dipping a little more deeply into their so-called Hindu roots and view how we view nature. It's not all about, you know, transforming India in a modern direction. That's necessary. But you have to have 5 or 10% of the land left for nature, which preceded all human cultures. So this is my granddaughter. She's 8. And one of my most moving moments was she, her mom, my wife, we all sat in a tree hide and saw a leopard walk together. I would never have seen a sight like that when I was 8 years old. So it makes me feel a little upbeat, you know. I think India is a functioning animal. And this is the kind of sight that I saw in 1994, and I hope others will continue to see in India. Thank you. Wow.